Good morning. My name is Justin Snyder, and I'll be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to another lecture presented by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing of Yahweh and existence was operation, or the operation was eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of the divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. The school was later incorporated in the state of California in 1958, and since that time, established branch schools throughout the continental U.S. and various parts of the world. The Arkport branch was established in the year 2000. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as they are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Father is Yahweh. This has been improperly substituted with the title Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. This has been improperly substituted with the title God. And the true name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua the Messiah. This has been erroneously substituted with the name Jesus Christ. Now Lord and God are titles and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Now Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That is, Elohim is the title that Yahweh chose for himself. Now Jesus is a name, but it's an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part to a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Greek, the Latin, or the Hebrew languages had any characters or letters that could produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a J in our own English language itself until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's life. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true name of the Father and the Son. Now Christ is a title just like Lord God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in his pure spirit state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. Now, Yahweh, on this cloud, has himself symbolized on this chart as a cloud, or symbolized himself as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular descriptive shape or form. We've illustrated this cloud all the way on the outside of this chart to show that everything on the chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Yahweh Elohim. This is the word or son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Later on, the selfsame spirit took on a physical body as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given among men for salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we all must ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth clean? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Bible. Now also in this school, we teach by the Divine Tabernacle Pattern. It's called the Divine Tabernacle Pattern because it's Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel, the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop of Mount Sinai and he gave him the pattern in the vision. He instructed Moses to build one just like it in the wilderness. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go about in this school to prove how that Everything in the universe is made and does operate according to the structure and functioning of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and how that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. In the school, we also have 10 primary constitutional aims or objectives, and they are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or the so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, psychology, philosophy, comparative religions, both modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose, operating throughout the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, dragon, the devil, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity throughout the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation or faith that was once delivered to the children or sons of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh ordained from the beginning that there is no other name given among men where we must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak the truth. At this time, we'd like to have a prayer by Nicole. And our scripture reading is going to be Hebrews 9, chapter 1 through 18. And I can read that.
Morning, class.
Good morning.
Glad that everybody is able to be here today, and the ones that are able to watch online. Continue to stay positive and focus on Yahshua, and just being thankful that even during this time we're able to still be able to perform class and continue to learn about him.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, praise the Lord.
How are you?
No, that's okay. All right. I'm going to read the scripture out of a Holy Name Bible. And the scripture reading is going to be Hebrews, the 9th chapter, 1 through 18. Then verily the first covenant had also orders of service and a worldly sanctuary. For in the first compartment of the tabernacle were the candlestick and the table and the showbread, which was called the holy place. And beyond the veil, second compartment of the tabernacle, which was called the most holy place, which had a golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded, and the table of the covenant. And over in the chair, over it, the cherubim of glory shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot speak particularly. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service. But into the second went the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Spirit signifying this, that the way unto the most holies had not been yet manifested, while the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meat and drink offerings, and various washings and carnal ordinances imposed upon them until the time of Reformation. But the Messiah, being a high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats or calves, but by his own blood entered once into the most holy, having obtained eternal inheritance for us, or eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Yahshua, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to the Most High, purge your conscience from death-causing works, to serve the living element. And for this purpose he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions of the First Testament, those which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a covenant is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For the covenant is made firm over the death of the victim. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Whereupon, neither the first covenant was confirmed without blood. That's Hebrews 9, 1 through 18. On behalf of the Arkport class, I'd just like to extend a warm welcome to everyone following us online, and thank Rob and Nicole for opening up their house so that we can have this little gathering here. And at this time, I'd like to call the first speaker, Dr. Bob Walker. Thank you.
I'd say good morning to everybody, and I'm happy and glad to be here. It's an honor and a privilege to testify to the things that I've learned about Yahweh and his purpose and plan since coming to class. Let's go to John 17 and 3. And one of the things I want to point out, we don't know in college, sticking up here. Who's online, and we appreciate anybody that's online, and hopefully they can come and learn about Yahweh and his purpose and plan through this great gospel. But one of the things I want to point out is we do use the true name of, Justin was pointing out, in the moderation of Yahweh, that's totally misrepresented out in the world, and the true divine title of Elohim and the true name of Yahshua the Messiah, see that walked around in the flesh. We do use the true names here, and we encourage you to check them out. You can look up the name Yahweh, and you'll find out that it is the true name. And Yahshua, see, coming in his Father's name, Yahweh, shortened form of Yahweh would be Yah. Yahshua, coming in his Father's name, would be Yah something. And so it's Yah, and Shua meaning salvation. So you got Yahweh is salvation. So we do use the true names here. And let's go to John 17 and 3 and try to explain some of the things that we do here.
John 17 and 3. And this is life eternal, that they might know that.
Now this is life eternal, that they might know thee. See, it's life eternal to know Yahweh. See, that's what life eternal is. See, some people think that it's lighting candles, doing these holy works. But it's life eternal to come to a knowledge and understanding of Yahweh. See, look, that mystery of iniquity, that devil opposes Yahweh. See, and he doesn't want you to know anything about Yahweh. But it's life eternal to know Yahweh, read.
Thou only art the true El and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
See, the only true El and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent. See, and that mystery of iniquity, like I said, is opposed the way that Yahweh is. Now look, let's go to Matthew 5 and 17. And this is, I've been thinking a little bit about, it's Easter Sunday out there in Christianity, and I've been thinking a little bit about why are they so messed up? You know, what? And it really does come down to the mystery of iniquity or that devil has deceived them. But one of the things is they don't know the purpose of Yahshua the Messiah. And that's what we're going to try to get across today. What was the purpose of Yahshua the Messiah? See, in a lot of religions out there, Christianity say he came in to set a Christian way of life. You got bumper stickers out there. What would Jesus do? See? Well, look, he didn't come in to start a Christian way of life. Matthew 5 and 17.
Think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
See, now think not that I have come to destroy the law and the prophets. Now, look, we encourage you to think about what we're reading here. See, now what are the law and the prophets that he's talking about? See, think not that I come to destroy the law and the prophets. The law would be the first five books of the Bible that Moses wrote. And the prophets are from Joshua and Malachi. See, think not that I come not come to destroy the law of the prophets, but I come to fulfill them. Now, the word fulfill means to finish or end or perform. See, what he's doing is he's fulfilling what's written back in the law of the prophets. See, actually, when Joshua came in, see that they called Jesus out in the world, his life story was written long before he came in on the scene. Everything that's written back in the law of the prophets is to testify of Yahshua the Messiah. Let's go to Matthew or John 5 and 39. I'm going to spend a few minutes on just trying to set a foundation up as to why we're doing what we're doing. Because this is how we come to a knowledge and understanding of Yahweh's purpose and plan.
John 5 and 39. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are that which testify of me.
Now look, Yahshua's speaking there. If you have a red letter edition, it says, ye search the scriptures, and you think you have eternal life. See, people think they can go home and read their Bible and memorize verses, and they think they have eternal life. But he's saying, for they testify of me, them scriptures, the Old Testament part of the Bible. Read that again, please, Nicole.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me.
Now, them scriptures testify of Yahshua. Now, look, he was not talking about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John when he made that statement. Right. Because they weren't even written yet. Mm-hmm. See? So that's something that we want to keep in mind. He wasn't talking about going back into Matthew. See? And we have people that run around and they'll have just half a Bible. It's called the New Testament. And they say, I'm a New Testament preacher. Well, look, we want to show you. See, this is not a product of a man's mind. We didn't think this up, and nobody else did. Dr. Henry C. Kinley had a divine vision straight from Yahweh. And you're going to see by the things that he showed us, and hopefully we can show you, that yes, he did. Because the way that he put the Bible together, you'll see how that there's no way that it could ever happen without coming straight from Yahweh. Now look, them scriptures testify of Yahshua. Let's go over to Luke 24 and 27.
Luke 24 and 27.
And look, I say this a lot because it's really helped me, and hopefully it'll help somebody else. If you get nothing out of today, one thing that you do want to get out of is that Yahshua came in to fulfill the scriptures or the law and the prophets for the Old Testament part of the Bible. And that the Old Testament part of the Bible is telling the story of Yahshua the Messiah. Because when you start looking at it that way, you're going to see what he's doing. Because what's happened is the world has set up an entirely different purpose of what the Savior was doing. You know, they think that, look, there's people that they carry the cross down Main Street this time of year because they think that's what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's not what Yahshua was doing, see? And hopefully we can get in and show you the things that he's doing. Go ahead and read Luke 24 and 27, please.
I'm going to start at 25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Now, we're not going to read this whole chapter, but we encourage you to go back and read it. You'll find out this is after Yahshua went through his death, burial, resurrection, and he's walking with two men to Emmaus, and these two men are all fretting and worried that, hey, this man that performed these miracles and stuff has died. And he's appeared unto them. They don't recognize him, see, because he was raised in a spiritual body. And they're all nervous. And he calls them, old fools and slow of heart to believe.
Mm-hmm.
See, and that's what, see, if we don't know the purpose of Yahweh, see, we're just old fools and slow of heart to believe. But if we know the purpose, that Yahshua came in, it'll give you comfort. See?
Right.
But all fools and slow of heart to believe, read.
All that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?
See, in all the prophets, see, you don't believe what the prophets have spoken. Ought Yahshua have suffered these things, read.
Mm-hmm. And to enter into his glory, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself.
So then what he did is he went right back to, and he began at Moses and all the prophets, the things concerning him. That's Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
And expounded unto them. See, that means great detail. Didn't just a couple of things. No, expounded unto them. See, the things that concerned him. Skip down to 44, please.
Mm-hmm. 44. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which are written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me.
See, this, and then he said to him, see, all things, there's that word fulfill again. See, all things must be, read that again, Justin, please.
And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you.
See, this is what I told you when I was yet with you. See, before I went through my death, burial, resurrection, read.
That all things must be fulfilled.
See, all things must be fulfilled. And that's what we need to get to understand the purpose of Yahweh. That Yahshua's purpose was to fulfill.
Right.
It was not to institute or start anything. It was to fulfill, see, the things that were written back here, read.
Which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me.
Now, were written in the Moses, and the prophets, and the Psalms concerning me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want to go back real quick to John 5, and I think it's probably about 33, maybe, where the works that bear witness to me.
Mm-hmm.
But you'll find out there's several places in the New Testament part of the Bible that Yahshua says that he come in to fulfill the law and the prophets. See, the law being the first five books of the Bible that Moses wrote, and the prophets being the books from Joshua to Malachi. So you cannot understand the purpose of Yahweh until you understand what the law and the prophets are doing, or testifying of Yahshua the Messiah, and he's coming in to fulfill. See, it's really law, prophets, fulfillment.
Mm-hmm.
We got that.
John 5 and 31. Start there.
Yeah.
If I bear witness of myself, ye will say, thy witness is not true.
See, now Yahshua's saying, if I bear witness of myself, you'll say my witness is not true. And that's, read.
There is another that beareth witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnesseth of me is true.
See, now that's John the Baptist. See, read.
Ye sent unto John, and he bare witness unto the truth. But I received not testimony from man.
See, I don't receive testimony of man, see, because he's already wrote his whole story up back here in the Old Testament part of the Bible. And this is called the elementary chart. And this chart, what it is different events that took place in the Bible that are pointing out Yahshua the Messiah. So, go ahead and read.
But these things I say, that ye might be saved.
See, now I'm telling you these things that you might be saved. Read.
He was a burning and a shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John.
Now remember when he said, I'm telling you these things that you might be saved. And then he says, I have greater witness than that of John. See, now John the Baptist was a true witness. But Yahshua the Messiah has a greater witness than that of John. See? What's that greater witness of John than John? Read.
For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works I do.
See, now the works that the Father have given me to do, see, them same works I do. Read.
And they bear witness of me.
See, now they bear witness of Yahshua. See, these different works that he set up, circumcision, ceremonies, Passover, Supper, Baptism, read.
That the Father hath sent me, and the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me. We have neither heard his voice at any time.
See, now these works, that's enough to go, but these works are the bearing witness of Yahshua the Messiah. So what was he doing?
Mm-hmm.
See, what was going on? See, now let's go to 1 Corinthians 15 and 1.
1 Corinthians 15 and 1.
And look, I can tell you that by coming to these classes on a regular basis, that you can come to no conclusion, but this great gospel is came straight from Yahweh himself.
That's right.
See, mm-hmm. And that's what we want to know what thus saith Yahweh. And mm-hmm. if you go back into and read Exodus, we encourage you to read it, the book of Exodus. We encourage you to read the whole Bible. If you go back and you see because Moses had a divine vision and revelation from Yahweh. See, and you read what Moses, when he talks to the children of Israel, what he says is, this is what thus saith Yahweh. This is what thus saith Yahweh. See, it wasn't a product of Moses' mind either. And that's what we want to know. What is thus saith Yahweh? See, and I can tell you this, that mystery of iniquity is going to oppose Yahweh. That's his job. See, go ahead and read 1 Corinthians 15 and 1.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand.
Now this is Paul writing a letter to the Corinthians, see? And this is in the self-same age that we're in today. And he's writing this letter, and he says, moreover, under brethren, start it again, please.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you.
See, I declare unto you the gospel that I preached unto you. This is what Paul's calling the gospel. See, and look, if you go into your Bible and you, I will do it. If you go to the book of Matthew, see, you're going to find it. It says the gospel according to Matthew. Mm-hmm. See, and if you go to Mark, it's going to say the gospel according to Mark. See, now Paul's writing a letter to the Corinthians, right? And he said, moreover, brethren, this is the gospel I preached unto you. Read. Start right at the beginning.
Moreover, brethren, I declared unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand.
See, you've received this gospel, and wherein you stand. And let me tell you, this is the gospel that we stand in. Read.
By which also ye are saved.
See, you're saved in this gospel. You can be saved in this great gospel that Paul was preaching or writing a letter to in the Corinthians, that we preach down here in this school, because we preach the same thing that Paul did. See, read.
If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have been believed in vain.
See, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain. See, and that's why we try to continue to have these classes. See, is so that you can keep in memory. Because look, when you don't do things, you have a tendency to forget. See, and that's why we want to have these classes to remind us all of this great gospel. See, read.
For I delivered unto you first all that which I also received.
Now Paul's saying, I delivered unto you first all that I have received. See, now let's see if he received any of it from Matthew. See, read.
How that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
Now this is what he calls the gospel. How Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures. Mm-hmm. What are the scriptures? See, the Old Testament part of the Bible, the law and the prophets, the books of Moses and the prophecy of the prophets. Them are the scriptures. And he calls the gospel how Yahshua died according to them scriptures. Mm-hmm. Read.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
See, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. See, that's what he calls the gospel. Now, how is that? Is there any more there?
And that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12.
See, now, let's go back here. And these are some of the scriptures laid out here. And look, we have a tabernacle pattern that Justin talked about in the moderation. And how in this tabernacle pattern, everything goes according to this tabernacle, and nothing escapes it. So you want it? We're going to show you how that. See, there's an example of how that they're down here in this tabernacle. In this tabernacle, Justin moves the camera, then I move. This tabernacle was what Yahweh gave Moses up here in the mount and told him to go down here in the wilderness of Sinai and build this tabernacle so that he could dwell among the children of Israel. And this tabernacle is what the children of Israel were camped around, and they came and worshiped Yahweh. See, now there's different principles in this tabernacle. And one of the things, this gospel is so simple that Dr. Kinley, after he had his divine vision and revelation, he said that if you can count to three, you can understand the purpose of Yahweh. This tabernacle was a most holy place in the court round about. See, one, two, three. There was three vessels in the court round about, three vessels in the holy place, and a three-in-one configuration in the most holy place. Now look, what you've got here is this tabernacle was, see, they made a covenant with Yahweh back there. And he set up this tabernacle, so when they broke a law, see, which they couldn't keep the covenant. When they broke a law, they had to offer up a sacrifice. So what you've got a principle of, you've got a principle of a death here. See, they die, the sacrifice had to die so that the sinner wouldn't. So you got a principle of a death. See, now remember what this is pointing out is Yahshua the Messiah. Because what they did is they'd offer up a lamb. And you'll find out that they offered up a lamb in the morning and a lamb in the afternoon. See, so you had a principle of a death, see. And then they would wash off that sacrifice in that water. And that was buried, see. So you got a death and a burial. And then that oil was poured over the priest to signify that the Holy Spirit was upon the priest so that he could minister all through the tabernacle efficiently. Death, burial, resurrection. See, you've got here in the tabernacle. And just remember, it's pointing out Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. And that's what the gospel is. See, this was written back here in Exodus, or Moses wrote about the tabernacle. See, now you got the migration of the children of Israel. And see, before they could get out of Egypt, there had to be the death of the lamb. See, so there was a death there. See, they were buried in the parted waters of the Red Sea. See, and then they resurrected out into the wilderness of Sinai. Death, burial, resurrection. See, it was 3 days journey. Death, burial, resurrection on the third. See, that's for the children of Israel. Pointing out Yahshua the Messiah. You got Abraham and King Melchizedek, or Abraham and Isaac, see. And what you've got here is you've got Isaac, or Abraham is told to offer up Isaac, see. And so what he does is he's got Isaac dead and buried. He's going to do what Yahweh tells him. He's got Isaac dead and buried in his mind. You got a death and a burial, see. And you'll read right over there in Hebrews, see, that he said, it says right in there that he offered up Isaac because he was going to do it. He was dead and buried in his mind. And you'll find out just a little, throw this out a little bit. Yahshua was crucified in the place of the skull. See, so where was he? Dead and buried, but in the place of the skull or mind. Point out, see how Yahshua, see, this is pointing out Yahshua the Messiah. Pointing out how that Isaac was dead and buried in Abraham's mind. And then there was 3 days journey up to Mount Moriah. And then Abraham realizes that the angel stays in Abraham's hand, so he doesn't have to kill Isaac. Isaac's resurrected in Abraham's mind. Death, burial, resurrection. See, then you got Noah and the preparation of the ark, see. And what's Noah doing? But he's preaching death. Look, it's going to rain. And you got to get into the ark. Dead. See, he's preaching death. See, they get into that ark. So there's a burial. See, death, burial. And then it rains, and what's that ark do? It resurrects on the waters. Death, burial, resurrection. See, there with Noah and his family. Then you got Adam, see. And Adam and Eve eat of that fruit of the tree, see, and place death on the whole world. See, on the four corners of the world, he placed death. See, and thorns and thistles, he's got to clear the land. He's buried in them thorns and thistles. See, and Yahweh says through childbearing, Adam and Eve could be saved. Death, burial, resurrection. See, point out Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. Then you go down here to the baptism and ministry, see. And what do they do? Let's get it in John 1:29. See, this is all in the Bible. We encourage you. We can show you that there's verses in the Bible that will show this. Mm-hmm.
John 1:29. The next day John seeth Yahshua coming unto him and saith, Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh which taken away the sin of the world.
See, behold, the Lamb of Yahweh that taken away the sin of the world. They call him the Lamb of the Yahweh. Why? Because it's written back here how, see, that lamb had to die to take sin away. See how it's written back here? See how the way they could get out of bondage of Egypt is that lamb had to die. See? And you're going to find out with Abraham and Isaac, you know, there was a ram caught in the thicket. That lamb had to die. See how that lamb had to die? The lamb had to die. See, this lamb, that's Yahshua's a baptism of ministry. That was a death sentence put on him. Death. Then he's baptized in the River Jordan, or burial. See, now this is a great gospel that should give us some comfort.
Mm-hmm.
See, that you can be saved in this if you keep in memory. This is salvation. We're preaching you salvation. See, and look, that mystery of iniquity is opposing it. He's got people out there doing Easter now. They are teaching death, burial, resurrection, because that's what it's pointing to, according to the scriptures. He's got them doing all kinds of stuff, carrying crosses, see,
mm-hmm.
thinking that they're doing something for Yahshua, see, but you got a death, a burial, see, and then he goes into the wilderness to be tempted or tested of the devil, death, burial, resurrection, see, and then you got Yahshua the Messiah actually coming in, and he's dying, see, is actually nailed to the cross, death, see, buried Joseph's new tomb, see, burial, and then he resurrects, see, 3 days, and he uses his resurrection for 40 days. Death, burial, resurrection. See, this is all pointing out Yahshua the Messiah. And this is that gospel that you can be saved in. See, these are the works that were set up back. See, he was the Lamb, so he had to do what the Lamb had to do. These are the works that were set up back here under the Old Testament part of the Bible. See, this is a great gospel, and it's simple enough. See, you got the creation, see. And my youngest daughter used to say when she was little, we do the creation, you know, and you got a death in the fall. See, everything dies. See, and then buried in the winter. See, if you don't have snow, you got rain, burial. And then in the spring, you got resurrection, death, burial, resurrection. See, on the third month. See, showing forth, pointing out Yahshua the Messiah. See, death, burial, resurrection. There is life after death. See, but look. This is how it works. The lamb died here. See, he's the lamb. The lamb died here. See, and look, this lamb was was offered up instead of the person. Now let's go to, I'm going to go to 1 John 5 and 7. And then I want to run, show you some things about blood, water, spirit. And then maybe show you something on the covenant and sit down.
John 5 and 7. The impotent man answered him, Sir,
no, First John.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I need the King James Bible because it's not in the holy. It's not in the right spot in the holy.
I can read it. 1 John 5 and 7. For there are three that bear witness, or there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one.
Now, there are three that bear record in heaven. See, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And the very first verse that we started out today was, eternal life is to know the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. See, you know these. So, there's three that bear witness in heaven. See, read.
Mm-hmm. And there are three that bear witness in the earth. The Spirit, the water, and the blood.
Now, these three that bear witness in the earth, spirit, water, and blood, what are, the question would be, what are they witnessing to?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they're witnessing to the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. See? So, look, it's blood, water, spirit. And look, there's no one that has ever gone onto the face of the earth without blood, water, spirit. See? Because that when you're born, see, there's a showing of blood.
Mm-hmm.
And doesn't the bag of waters break? Water.
Yeah. Yeah.
See? And then you take in that breath of life, and breath and spirit go together. Blood, water, spirit. See, there's life in blood, water, spirit.
Yeah.
And that's how you're born from below. So how are you born from above? Blood, water, spirit. Now these principles, take a look at these principles. See, and we've got them. Dr. Kinley had this vision, and this is the vision actually painted right out on a chart. This chart he used for years. It's that vision painted right on a chart. And this is all the vision that he's seen painted out on these charts. See, and I heard one time that somebody said, hey, I'd like to have the vision you have.
Yep.
And he said, hey, help yourself.
Yep.
See, and it's amazing. You come down and you look at these charts and it's like, it's exactly what's in the Bible. And it really gives you a greater understanding of what is written in the Bible. See, now look, what you've got is these witnesses of blood, water, spirit. See, blood. See, they had to offer up a sacrifice. There's blood. They killed the sacrifice. Blood, water, and the laver. Blood, water, and that oil signified spirit on that priest. Blood, water, spirit. And there was 40 steps going up into the most holy place. Blood, water, spirit, 40. You got the children of Israel, see, and what they have to do. See, we're not making this up. And some people, if you've read just a little bit of your Bible or heard a little bit of your Bible, you'll find out. See, the children of Israel are down here in Egypt, and what they have to do to get out, they had to kill that lamb, and they had to put the blood on the top of the door, the two side posts, and the base, and they drew it at the bottom. Blood, water, spirit, see, and they were in the wilderness for 40 years. See, blood, then they go to the part of water of the Red Sea, water, see, and led by that cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, which Yahweh was in her spirit. Blood, water, spirit, 40. See, you got Abraham and Isaac, see. And we talked about how that Abraham was to offer up Isaac, see. And then Yahweh stayed his hand or had an angel stay his hand, see, and there was a ram caught in the thicket. So they offered up that ram caught in the thicket, see, blood. See, and look, Isaac is a type of Yahshua, but ain't no man coming in, see, other than Yahshua the Messiah dying for somebody. It was sacrifices. And you take a look at your vertebrae, they give you your uprightness.
Mm-hmm.
They all look like different animals. See, mm-hmm. There's not one the shape of a man that would make you walk upright. It's Yahshua the Messiah that can make us walk upright. See, it wouldn't have done any good with Isaac, because Yahshua's the only one that can die. See, and Dr. Kinley would say, look, you can hang me up out there, and I'm just another dead person.
Mm-hmm.
See, because it's Yahshua that's got to die for your sins. See, but these are examples or types, that ram, blood, see, and you got the sweat of Abraham's brow, water, see, blood, water, and that spirit, that angel of Yahweh stays Abraham's hand. And Israel was 40 years old. Blood, water, spirit, 40. And then you've got Noah and his family, see? And what's going on is Noah's got to get the blood off his head. And you can read it. I think it's over in Ezekiel 37, or we're not going to get it. But look, if you've got information that can save somebody's life and you don't tell them, the blood's on your head. But if you have the information, you tell them, and they still do it, the blood's on their head. So what Noah do here is he got the blood off his head. Blood. See, and then lots of rain, see, coming up from the bottom, coming down from the top, see, a lot of water, blood, water, and then that spirit shut the door of the ark. Blood, water, spirit. And then it rains for 40 days and 40 nights. Blood, water, spirit, 40. You got Adam, see, what's he do is they touch on the fruit, puts blood, see, on the four corners of the earth, blood, see. And then he has to clear that land, sweat, water, see. And then that angel of Yahweh, or that spirit, see, Michael, keeps them from getting back into the garden. Blood, water, spirit, see. You'll find out, you come back to class, you'll find out according to Moses' vision, when he's seen the days of creation and mankind coming in, you're going to find out according to Moses' vision, he was in there for 40 days. In Moses' vision in that garden. Blood, water, spirit, 40. See? And then you got Yahshua the Messiah, see? And they called him the lamb, see? Just like the lamb's blood back here. See? And the lamb's blood back here, see? Now he's the lamb. You got blood, see? And then you got him buried in the water, see? This thing is simple. There's no reason why we can't understand it. See? See, he's baptized in the Jordan River water. See, and then John sees that spirit ascend on Yahshua, blood, water, spirit. And then what has he done? Or what's he doing? He goes back up into the wilderness of Sinai. See, being tested of the devil for 40 days. Blood, water, spirit, 40. See, and then you've got, see, What is it? See, back here, this blood, water, spirit is bearing witness to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. See, you want to know something about Yahshua? You better know something about blood, water, spirit.
Mm-hmm.
See? And look, like I said, there's no man's got into this earth without blood, water, spirit. And look, you get a cut on your hand, what do? Mm-hmm. So you got blood coming out.
Clean it.
You clean it up. Wash it.
Mm-hmm.
See? Water.
Mm-hmm.
See? And then you put ointment on it. Some type of ointment. See? Spirit. Blood, water, spirit. See? Cut yourself shaving. See? Blood.
Mm-hmm.
See? Hopefully you don't dry shave. See? Water. Mm-hmm. See? And then what do you got? Shaving cream? And what is that? A cloud? Mm-hmm. And what do we hear back here with Yahweh illustrates himself as a cloud? See? Mm-hmm. Or spirit. See? Now look, we go down here to Yahshua Messiah. See, and he's on the cross. And we could probably get this, actually. Let's go to, I think it's John 19. Look at John 19 somewhere where it says that where they're cursing the Messiah. I think that might be, but I think it's too far. Anyway, what you got is you got Yahshua the Messiah, and he's being pierced in the side. And read right in the book how that they pierced him. You got it?
Yeah, John 19:34. Well, let's start at 33. But when they came to Yahshua, they saw that he was dead already. They broke not his legs. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water.
See, out came blood and water. Here's a couple of side things that can go on there. See, they broke the legs of the thief on the right side, or is that the left side? Right side, and they broke the legs of the thieves on the other side. Mm-hmm. See, but they didn't break Yahshua's legs.
Right.
Because, see, back here,
No bones
could be broken in that lamb.
That's right.
See, no bones broken.
Mm-hmm.
See, so they didn't break Yahshua's legs. They see he's dead already, and they pierce him in the side. See, so now comes blood and water. Now look, what they did is they broke the legs of the guy here on the right. So what do? They go by Yahshua, and they break the legs of the guy on the left. So what's that make Yahshua? But see, they passed over Yahshua. See how just like he's the lamb was the Passover lamb here, they passed over from death to life. See, they passed over Yahshua. And when he resurrects, see, that brings life more abundantly.
Mm-hmm.
So you got blood and water here with Yahshua, piercing the side. And then you can read where he gave up the ghost. Or also, see, he didn't resurrect a physical body.
Mm-hmm.
He resurrected a spiritual body. See, so you got blood, water, spirit. And he's a resurrection for 40 days. Blood, water, spirit, 40. You got Jews Pentecost, see. And look, what you got in Jews Pentecost is, it's really the Passover supper and Yahshua washing their feet, see. Now, why? Because now they understand that Passover supper, what's it all about? And it was the Last Supper. And we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. But it was the Last Supper.
Yeah.
What's that all about? See, it's they're learning. See, it wasn't about sitting down and eating crackers and grape juice. And that's not what they did there anyway. It was a feast. They had lamb.
Mm-hmm.
See, bitter herbs. They had a feast there. See, but they're learning that, see, what it's about is showing forth the blood of Yahshua. See, and then they wash their feet. See, there's water there. What's that all about? Washing their feet. See, it's not about washing feet. It's about getting your soul cleaned up.
Mm-hmm.
See, and understand there's a heel on your soul. See, you got blood and water. And then they're up there in the upper room, blood, water, spirit. See, that's what that's all about. Blood, water, spirit. See, and then you got the persecution of the Jews. You've got Stephen killed. See, blood. See, and then you got Philip baptizing that Ethiopian eunuch, see, in water. See, so you got water. And then you got, and you'll find out that this is in the blood is in the seventh
chapter of Acts, eighth chapter of Acts talks about Philip baptizing the Ethiopian eunuch. And then in the ninth chapter of Acts, you're going to find out that that spirit pulled Philip away from there. You got blood, water, spirit. See, and then you've got the Gentiles' conversion. And what you got is the 10th chapter of the 12th chapter talks about James being killed. See, you got blood. The 11th chapter is talking about how the Peter went and preached to the Gentiles. And he said, can any man forbid thee water?
Mm-hmm.
See, but then he says, and he's telling them, then remembered I how that John baptized by water. But Yahshua was baptized by fire and spirit. So you have blood, and can any man forbid thee water? And then the 7th chapter is that Gentiles are receiving that Holy Spirit. Blood, water, spirit. See, and then what do you got? You got that apostate church. See, and look, it's set up. You could take a look at Christianity. And the Roman Catholic Church is just the mother of Christianity. All them other churches came off Roman Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
See, but what do they want to do? Is they want to resurrect their blood. See, they want sacrifices, although they call it the unbloody sacrifice, but there is no remission of sin without the blood. See, but you've got, they want to restore all these carnal ordinances of baptisms and water. See, blood and water. See, and it's that unholy spirit. See, now look, this is bearing witness of Yahshua the Messiah. See, and one of the things I want to tell you real quick, and then I don't have a whole lot of time, but I want to do one other thing, is I went to the 1975 International Convention, and I was pretty young at the time. I think I was probably 13. I don't remember. Yeah, I was 13, I guess it was. And I remember they had a kids class there. And I don't know who the girl was, but there was a young lady that was probably around my age at that time. We got up and she talked about how that Dr. Kinley would tell you, blood, water, spirit, blood, water, spirit. And I don't remember a whole lot about that convention, but that's one thing that Yahshua has put on my mind, and I'm happy and glad to say, I'm glad that he put that on my mind, to know there's importance of this blood, water, spirit. And it sure gives me rest. And he's got it painted right here on this chart. Now we're going to switch gears here for a minute, because I want to show you this Passover Supper and show you how this actually works. Let's go to Exodus 12:1. And we got to remember how Yahshua's fulfilled. Yahshua is fulfilling what was written back in the Law and the Prophets.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's read Exodus 12:1. And these are works that Yahweh has given him to finish, and they bear witness of them. Go ahead and start reading.
Exodus 12:1. And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months.
Now this month shall be the beginning of months. You're going to find out it's the month of April. See, they start with the month of April. And you're going to see that I can't write on the board very good, but hopefully this will help you. Go ahead and read.
It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their father, of their fathers, a lamb for a house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his house take it according to the numbers of souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male for the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
Now you're going to find out that we're not, this is just kind of a little sidetrack, but you're going to find out, see, that lamb had to be without spot and blemish. Yash was that lamb without spot and blemish.
Mm-hmm.
See, read.
And ye shall keep it until the 14th day of that same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill in between the two evenings.
See, now the whole assembly or the 12 tribes of Israel are going to kill this. Read.
And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein these they shall eat it.
Now they're going to eat it in their houses. See, that's not even the way they do it now. They go to churches. See, you got to eat it in your houses. Read.
And they shall eat the flesh in the night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it.
They're going to have unleavened bread, and the reason it's unleavened is because Yahshua hasn't risen yet, see? And there's bitter herbs. Why is it bitter herbs? See, it's bitter herbs because that old covenant, see, there was works involved. It's bitter. See, read.
Eaten out of it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the inwards thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover.
Did you get there in there where there that it was done at night? And then I want, I think it's 14. Do this in memory.
Exodus 12 and 14. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to Yahweh throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance of forever.
See, now this was done so that a memory, so that when they could remember how the Yahweh, see, had them take out that lamb and put the blood on the door, see, and then they come out through the parted waters of the Red Sea. This was a feast so that they could remember that.
Yep.
See, now you can go down there and get crackers and grape juice. What do you remember from that? See, it was, and this covenant was given to the Jews and the Jews only. Now look, Yahshua is fulfilling this. And when you understand that Yahshua is fulfilling this, what you'll see is that's just garbage when they got you down there doing crackers and grape juice. See, now let's go to Matthew 27. Let me give you the verse right here so I can. 26, 17 through 20. Let me have this. It gives me the verses that we don't have to waste time looking for.
Matthew 26, 17.
Yep, 220.
Matthew 26, 17.
Now look, Yahshua's fulfilling this Passover Supper. And you'll find out all through the prophets where they talked about doing the Passover Supper. See, they got that every single year. See, it's what's written in the law and the prophets, read.
Now the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Yahshua, saying unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? And he said, go into the city to such a man, and say unto him, the rabbi saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples.
See, they got to eat in their houses. He didn't say go to the synagogue. See, he's fulfilling, keep setting up that Passover. He started it here. He's ended it with the 12 tribe or the 12 disciples, read.
And the disciples did as Yahshua had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. Now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12.
See, now, when the evening comes, so they're doing it at night, because why? Because that's the way it was set up back here. It was done at night. And he sat down with the 12 disciples, just like you got the 12 tribes of Israel. Read.
And they did eat. He said, verily, I say unto you, and that one of you shall betray me.
Okay, is that 20?
That was 21.
Okay, read 26.
Matthew 26, 26. And as they were eating, Yahshua took bread and blessed it.
Now, as they were eating, what were they eating? Well, back here on the menu was lamb. So what were they eating? Lamb. See, and you'll find out they killed the Passover. See, but they were eating lamb. And as they were eating, he took bread. See, you got unleavened bread here. See, they were eating. He took bread and blessed it, read.
And broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink, ye all of it.
What is in the cup? See, that bitter herbs. See, and we were talking about, see, how that, it was in the month of April, at the time of the Passover. See, we're going to get memory here in a second, but I want to pull this away here. I want to show you something on this chart. See, back here in Pentecost, we got these pictures here of them doing the Passover Supper and the washing of the feet.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Is that because it goes on after? No. It's so because now they understand what they were doing back there.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't so they could keep doing it. It's now we understand what the Passover Supper is. And it's really coming down. And look, when you come down to class, what do? We're offering you up. We're showing you lamb. we're offering lamb to you. Mm-hmm. See, and it's not unleavened bread no more. We're offering you the bread of life, or Yahshua the Messiah. See? Now look, go down to, or skip over to Luke 22:19.
Luke 22:19. For this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of Yahweh shall come. But behold the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. And truly the Son of Man goeth.
Is that Luke 22:19?
Luke 17.
Okay. Sorry. Luke 22:17.
Luke 22:17. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me.
See, he's saying, do this in remembrance of me. Why is he saying, do this in remembrance of me? So they can continue to do it? No, because back here, he's fulfilling, see, do this in remembrance of me. See, he's fulfilling this way of worship. That's why he's saying it. And it's the same thing back here. They're starting to understand what it all is all about. Now, look, I want a couple more verses. I'm going to sit down. I want to go to Luke, right there in Luke 22. Go to 7 through 12.
Luke 22:7.
And just, you know, I'll tell you, Yahweh's got this thing together. It's locked up. You can't unlock it. See, it's locked up. And there's so many things that, if you take a look and just look at the purpose of Yahweh, you're going to see how that everything goes together. See, go ahead and read.
Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, behold, then ye are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entered in. And ye shall say unto the good man of the house, the rabbi saith unto thee, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished, there make ready.
See, now where are they going to eat the Passover supper? See, when he's fulfilling it, in a large upper room. See, and didn't we talk about how that the Jews, they were up in the upper room? It's the same upper room. See, they're waiting for that Holy Spirit, but they're going to have the Passover in that large upper room. Now, what does that have to do with anything? Let's go to Acts, second chapter, I believe it is. No, first chapter, 13.
Acts 1:13. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphae, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the brother of James.
Now you have that a type. See, they're up in that upper room. It's not a type. They are actually up in the upper room, and that's where they received that Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how is that significant today? See, that's what we're doing down here in class today, see? And we want you to partake of that Passover supper. See, we want you to pass. When we walk in here, every single one of us, we walk in here dead.
Mm-hmm.
And we want you to pass over from death to life.
That's right.
Because that great gospel has the ability to bring you from death to life. See, deliver you. That's the word I'm looking for. Deliver you from death to life. But look, where did they receive the Holy Spirit? See, they received the Holy Spirit in the upper room. See, where do we receive the Holy Spirit? See, this is our body's a house, and it's in the upper room in the head. See, we want you to eat that lamb. See, here in your mind, see, we want you to see the things and eat that lamb. Let's go to Jeremiah 3:15. And I appreciate everybody coming. And look, there's a whole lot to this. We can get in and explain
how Yahshua was dead, buried, and resurrected. And we can show you the 3 days and the purpose of Yahweh according to the Bible. There is a whole lot here. And Daniel's vision, we can show you how that and here's the problem. Even in Daniel's vision, when he got the 2,300 days with Yahshua, one of the issues is, I'm not going to get into it because I want to sit down. But one of the issues is they think that there's just physical temple that's going to be cleansed. When it's really Yahshua the Messiah's physical body. See, they want to keep that physical body and cleanse the physical temple. That physical body that he got rid of, see, or cleansed that temple after the 2,300 days. See, but go ahead and read that and we'll sit down.
Jeremiah 3:15. And I will give you pastors according to mine heart.
See, I'll give you pastors according to my heart, Reed.
Which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding.
Feed you with knowledge and understanding. See, that's what we're doing now. It's not that we're eating a physical lamb, that we're eating physical bread. See, Yahshua was that lamb that we're eating now. He's the lamb. Didn't he say that I'm the bread of life? And really, it's all broken down into this tabernacle pattern. He's the sacrifice. That's what this tabernacle is showing you. He's the sacrifice. See, he's going to take us and clean us up. See, you can read that in Ezekiel 36. He's the washing of regenerations. He's that Holy Spirit. See, he's the light of the world. See, and these pastors are going to feed you with knowledge and understanding. And when you get knowledge and understanding, isn't that likened unto light? Mm-hmm. See, and look, the bread of life, it wasn't physical loaves of bread. It was knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. See, take on that Holy Spirit. See, and that's what they received in that upper room, that Holy Spirit. See, and he's the intercessor between Yahweh and man. See, that's what we're trying to feed you. Is there any more there? Read it again, and then I'll sit down.
And I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding.
See, I'll give you pastors of my own heart. We'll feed you with knowledge and understanding. See, that's what we get down here. That's what we're doing. We're feeding you with knowledge and understanding. See, read.
And it shall come to pass when ye be multiplied and increased in the land. In those days, saith Yahweh, they shall say no more.
Okay, I just encourage everybody to continue to come to class. But what I want to get across is how the things that were written back here in the Old Testament part of the Bible, see, are really testifying to Yahshua the Messiah and get you to the point where you can know Yahshua on a personal basis and come to a knowledge and understanding. And I just encourage everybody to continue to come to class, see. Don't get hung up in all this flesh. And that's the problem, see, is Christianity wants to give you a physical unleavened bread. That's not going to do you any good. We want you to think different, see, and see how that Yahshua has got to be priority in your life. And when Yahshua's priority in your life, there's nothing that, because it's spirit. And Yahweh is spirit, and he's truth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
I'll be your next speaker, and I've enjoyed class thus far, and it's always an honor and a pleasure to give a reasonable testimony of the things that I've learned since coming down to the school. And you know, none of us would know anything, just reiterate on some of the things we were talking about last class, this did come directly by divine vision and revelation, directly from Yahweh himself. And that's the way that he has given man the knowledge of him from the get-go. But he has made it, made everything according to this pattern of himself, which is a simple threefold pattern of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. And we can see how that in the creation, there's a multiplicity of witnesses that are witnessing to that this is true, that this tabernacle is the tabernacle of all things. And your body is a great witness of it being a head cavity, a chest cavity, an abdominal cavity. There's three parts, but one body, you see? And then your makeup is spirit, soul, and body. And that's a perfect reflection of how that Yahweh is the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, just like it was talked about there over in 1 John 5 and 7, you see. And you could just go on, you could go on your whole life looking at the creation alone and seeing how that everything is three in one, you see. And, you know, just the fact that we make the declaration in the moderation of that absolutely nothing escapes that pattern, you can wrap that up just in the structure of an atom, because all matter is made out of atoms, and an atom is simply a proton, a neutron, an electron. There's three parts, but it's just one atom. And all matter, you know, or spirit materialized, matter really you can trace back to mother. So you really got pater, he's the pater, or the father, you see, the pater. And so he is both mother and father, you see. And that's why when he makes the first man Adam, you see, he comes in and the woman is still within him. He is both male and female. So why don't we go over there to Genesis and pick up where and make man in our image and our likeness. Our, you know, it seems peculiar when you have the creator, which we always thought was a male deity. We got him as a god. You see, that's what a god is a male deity. But guess what? A god cannot bring forth offspring. A god needs a goddess. A lord needs a lady. That's why these are inadequate substitutions for the true name and the title of Yahweh Elohim. You see, see, he is both male and female within himself. And that's, like I was saying, he's both pater, or father, and mother, or matter. Okay? And so he makes the first man, Adam, as a reflection of that. You see, or a witness back here. And so he is made both male and female in himself. And then the woman is drawn out. Okay, you find that, Jen?
Genesis 1 and 26.
Thank you.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image,
mm-hmm.
after our likeness.
That's right. Let us make man after our image and in our likeness. Okay, read.
And let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the cattle, and
yeah,
over
so,
all earth.
So he's going to be given dominion too, or as a king, you see, and that's a reflection of the a most holy place principle. You can see it. See, this is them in the garden, in perfect peace, you see. Now, if you come through here, look at here, you've got King Melchizedek, and he's blessing Abraham back here. So you got kings. See, back here, when the temple is made, that's made by King Solomon. The instructions of it were given to David. You see that he's a king. You see, so you're going to see that he was made a king back here. What's it point now? King of kings.
Yeah.
You see, Yahshua. Right. See, he's going to come forth, go through that death, burial, and resurrection according to the scriptures, just like it's being talked about. You see, and then he's going to ascend upon high. And see him here now? After he's going to, you know where he's going to rule, or where his throne is now? Right here in the hearts of man, the mind, mankind. You see, because after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, see, now you got a king. See, this is who should be ruling on your throne, right? He's King of Kings. That's right here on this chart, King of Kings. You see, and then it's got a picture of a heart and a representation of that law back there. It's showing you that new law is going to be written in the hearts of man, in the hearts and minds of mankind. Okay.
Yeah.
Why don't we jump over there to?
You might want Genesis 1 and 27.
Okay.
Genesis 1 and 27. So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he them.
Thank you, Nicole. That wraps it up right there. That it shows that Adam was made both male and female in himself, you see. And then the woman is drawn out, you see. And that's when she gets herself in some trouble, you see. That's when she's deceived by this mystery of iniquity, right? And she does take of that fruit, but... You see, as a type, you see, what you want to see is that these types of shadow are going to show you something about Yahshua. You see, and then Adam, see, being a good husband unto his wife, you see, is going to willingly take of that fruit. See, he's willingly going to die for his bride, you see, just like Yahshua. See, he's willingly going to die for his bride, his spiritual bride. You see, this was a physical example back here. You see, then he's going to have a spiritual reality over here. Okay, let's work with these covenants a little bit. Let's go over to Jeremiah 31:31. You see, because you're going to see, if you want to go over here to
yep,
this chart,
yep.
You're going to see over here that this Old Testament, you see, was right on here, we've got that it was carnal ordinances. And we actually got Hebrews 9:10 right on the chart, see, that which was our scripture reading. And you see, what you're going to see is that this stood in meats and drinks and diverse washings, you see. And this thing was imposed upon them until the time of Reformation, which is what you've got here, or being reformed by Yahshua the Messiah. So there's going to be a change. A Reformation is going to bring about a change. This event brought about a great change, okay?
Jeremiah 31 and 31. Mm-hmm. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel.
See, there already been an old covenant established back here with Israel. You see, but behold, the days come that I'm going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel.
And with the house of Judah.
And with the house of Judah, because see, at that time, those houses were divided, all right? Read.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers, mm-hmm. in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt.
Now listen, he's obviously talking about when he took their fathers out of the land of Egypt. This event right here, where he takes the children of Israel from bondage to the Egyptians, you see? Right about this time of year, he takes them through them divided waters of the Red Sea. You see, that's when he took them by the hand. Read.
Which my covenant they break.
You see, but that covenant they did break. You see, that it was evident that they broke it. It didn't even take them that long. You see, Moses on his second trip up here, he was up here some 40 days. And before he even came down from them 40 days, they had corrupted themselves. You see, and they had dragged these things right over.
That's right.
That they had learned in Egypt. And they started worshiping this golden calf and saying, this be the Elohim that brought us out of Egypt. You see, and believe you me, idol worship is on Yahweh's hot list for things he don't like. And it's man has been doing it and repeating it for years
That's
and
right.
years. But guess what? You see, the reason is there's a mystery of iniquity in operation too. You see, this old snake, he's going to be right there. You see, and what you had here is even though those bodies of them Egyptians died off in the Red Sea, the spirits that were influencing them came right over and got in these leaders of Israel, you see, and see that they corrupted themselves here. Read.
Although I was a husband unto them.
See, and he was a good husband unto him, just like he was a good husband unto Eve. You see, Dr. Kinley used to call this the greatest love story ever told, physically so, because it's pointing out the greatest love story there ever is. What all the other love stories are pointing to is that Yahshua so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, or Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, Yahshua. So, and what did he do it for, you see? So for the saving of a soul, you see, it wasn't for naught. Read.
Saith Yahweh, but this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house
see,
of Israel.
See, now this is going to be the new covenant that I'm going to make with the house of Israel. Read.
After those days, saith Yahweh.
See, after these days right here is what he's talking about. After those days, that death, burial, and resurrection, you see, of Yahshua's Messiah and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Read.
I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts.
See, this one here, it was external to them. You see, there was nothing wrong with the law. It was that the people couldn't keep it because it wasn't in them to keep it. You see? See, so that first table of stones, he comes down and it says that Moses waxed hot. He was angry, you see, and he cast those down, showing that they wouldn't be able to keep this old carnal law. You see, it was broken. Israel wasn't going to be able to keep it, okay? But you see, he went up with his own heart, as it were. Moses was the hewn out stones, likened unto the first. Take them up, see, and that law was written on those. Showing that it need to be written on the heart and minds of mankind. You see, that's what that's showing, is that Moses, it's like Moses taking his own heart up there. You see? And see, there wasn't a place for that first tables of stone to be put. The tabernacle wasn't erected yet. It hadn't been built. So there wasn't even a place to put it. That's showing you something about this new law, because now when those second tables of stone are brought down, the tabernacle has been established. It's been set up in the wilderness. You know, now it has a place to be put, okay? Okay, so now this new law, it's not going to be written with pen and ink. It's not going to be written on their clothes and stuff like the Jews were doing back here. See, they had that law written all over them. You see, it's not going to be like that. It's not going to be a physical way of worship. You see, there aren't going to be physical sacrifices. There's going to be one sacrifice made by Yahshua the Messiah for all to nail those things to the cross. See all these things he's got here? Then he nailed these to the cross to bring in this new covenant that's going to be written in the hearts and minds of mankind. Read.
And written in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people.
See, they shall be my people. He's going to have a people. You might as well get on board, you see? Okay. I want to go over to, I'm going to change gears a little bit. I got something on my mind from something I saw a brother in Springfield working with. Let's go over to Psalms 19:1. I'm not much of a word reader, writer either, but.
Psalms 19:1.
Mm-hmm.
The heavens declare the glory of El, and the firmament showeth his handiwork.
Now this scripture here, a lot of times it goes right along with what we call our theme song, Romans 1:19-20. You see that the physical things are going to reveal the spiritual things of Yahweh. All right. And this is saying, go ahead and start from the beginning again.
The heavens declare the glory of El,
mm-hmm.
and the firmament sheweth his handiwork.
That's right. That's firmament. These things that he made are showing his handiwork. All right. Read.
Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night sheweth the knowledge.
Okay, day after day uttereth speech. See, though these things in the creation are testifying of the Creator. The creation is going to show forth the Creator, okay? Day unto day, uttereth speech, night unto night, show with knowledge. Read.
There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard.
See, there are no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. This is a universal language that you've been talking about here. Read.
Yet their message has gone out through all the earth, and their story to the end of the world.
Yep, read.
And then hath he set a tabernacle for the sun.
Okay, I wrote this board here, this word on the board right here. I wasn't familiar with it until I looked it up, okay? Now what this word refers to is a tracking of the sun at noon on an annual basis, okay? That's what this word means here. And what you're gonna find is if you're in a set position on the earth and you track the movement of the sun at noon for an entire year, there's going to be a circuit, as it were, okay? And that circuit is going to be just like this. It's going to be a figure eight. That's a pretty bad eight, but and you can track this all. What you're doing is you're tracking the sun at noon throughout the whole year, okay? And this is going to go right along with what's being talked about here in Psalms, because there's a circuit, all right? All right, go ahead and read.
Which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber and rejoiceth as strong man to run a race.
He, as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, he rejoiceth to run a race, you see? See, he's coming out of here with some strength. Read.
He is going forth. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it.
You see how he's picking up a circuit here? His going forth is, go ahead and read that again.
His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it.
His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit is from the end of it. You see? And you see that how this is a figure eights up here, you see, and this is a circuit. And we learn here down here that there's an operation with these things, you see. And Adam all dies. See, he bring the purpose on down. Now, Yahshua all can be made alive, you see, that believe in his gospel. See, so there's a coming down and there's a coming up, you see. Just like here with Noah, you see, he comes down, Noah, it comes on up. Those who got in the ark were saved, you see. The promise is given to Abraham, you see, and you see his seed is gonna come on down. You see how the promise is given to him and all. He's told when Yahweh has told him that his seed is gonna be in bondage to a people down there, or they're gonna be put in a land that they know not. You see, and they're gonna be evilly entreated. You see, that's the children of Israel. They see they're in bondage, and then they're delivered by that great name of Yahweh up out of there. You see how it's a circuit, a coming down and going up. That's what this is showing you. And guess what? This is really something. Where this thing crosses, you know what time of year that is? April 14th. It makes a cross.
That's cool.
Wait, that right there, that's right about the middle of April.
That's cool.
Or April 14th is where it crosses. Now, why is it doing that? Why is the sun, making a circuit at noon, you see, and crossing April 14th,
yeah, yeah.
Because it's pointing out the true sun.
You see, it's pointing out Yahshua Messiah, just like he was pointing out the lamb here. You see, that's what that's pointing to. See, and that's the time of year that he got on the cross, okay? I thought that was a really cool point.
It's really neat.
Come on, finish
it. Yep, go ahead.
And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof.
See, there's nothing hid from the heat thereof. You see, there's nothing hid. You can't get away from Yahweh, you see. And you wouldn't want to if you knew him anyways. Mm-hmm. You want to be a part of that heat, you see. See, when he lights you up, you're on fire for this thing.
Yep.
You see, and that's a beautiful testimony here. I've heard that from people. And, you know, as soon as this truth has been revealed to them, they're on fire, you know. From there on out, you see, and that's what we want to be. We want to be lit up with that truth. Just like here, it was unto them that cloven tongues of fire, you see, because they were lit up with the truth, and they had something to preach to the world, you see, that one could be saved, you see, in this great gospel of Yahshua's death, burial, and resurrection. It's just beautiful. Well, go ahead and see.
The law of Yahweh is perfect.
See, this law of Yahweh is perfect. You see, this law of Yahweh is perfect. And what is it perfect at doing?
Converting the soul.
See, this thing can convert your soul. See, this back here that was external with them, it wasn't anything wrong with the law as it were, but the people couldn't keep it. You see, it was physical. It was carnal. You see, it was pertaining to the flesh. You see, the flesh cannot be made perfect. But see where he fell here? He fell in his consciousness here. You see, and that's where the man needed to be picked up. He didn't, there was nothing wrong with his body. You see, he lived another 930 years,
yeah.
You see. But his conscience, you see, had been darkened. You see, he had been, here he was one with his creator, and then here he's separated. See. Sorry. Go ahead and read.
The testimony of Yahweh is sure.
See, this law of Yahweh is perfect in converting the soul. See, the testimony of Yahweh is sure. Read.
Making wise the simple.
See, we're simple people down here. You see, when I see how that there's a tabernacle pattern in which all things can operate, and it's a simple 1, 2, 3 pattern. You see, in the vessels in there are simple 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 3 and 1 up here. That's some simple stuff, but yeah, you know what? This can make you wise.
Yep.
You see, when you see this operation of his son in the tabernacle, in this greater and more perfect tabernacle, and you see that operation, you see, you can see that this is a tabernacle, this is a pattern, you see, and how that, see, that there must have been a death of the lamb. You see, they were buried or they were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. And they resurrected out here to worship Yahweh, you see. And they were out here 40 years. See, that's blood, water, spirit, 40. That's death, burial, resurrection. See, that can make you wise. That's the wisdom of Yahweh, you see. Read.
The statutes of Yahweh are right.
See, his statutes are right, you see. Read.
Rejoicing the heart.
That's right. You know what it said over there? It said that his commandments are not grievous. You see, these things are something to be rejoiced about. You know, this was imposed upon them. This isn't what it's talking about over here. This is a type and a shadow, you see, to bring you to the Messiah, to see that he did the works of the Father that Rob was talking about over there in John the 5th chapter, you see. Those are the things that he come in and he finished them. So don't call Yahshua the Messiah a liar go back to this physical way of worship. That would just be ridiculous, you see, because he done accomplished what he set out to do the works of the Father. You see, read.
The commandment of Yahweh is pure,
mm-hmm.
Enlightening the eyes.
See, these things can enlighten you. You see, you could be lit up, read.
The fear of Yahweh is clean,
yep.
Enduring forever.
And believe me, you know, sometimes it might take a little wrath of Yahweh for you to understand what fear really is. So you need to respect Yahweh. He's, you know, this isn't no sky god that we're talking about here. This is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. You see, he is a great Elohim. His wisdom, his intelligence, his knowledge, his love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength are so far beyond our finite mind and not even funny. But the things that can be known of Yahweh it's just, I'm just eternally grateful that he has allowed me to come down here and to see some simple principles of him, and to recognize that he is the only righteousness there is. You see, the world's righteousness, they think that they can work up on things, and we all thought that we could be good. Now, I'm not saying you just go purposely be bad. That's not what I'm saying, but I'm saying that, see, without his Holy Spirit in you, you're not going to be right. Read.
The judgments of Yahweh are true and righteous altogether.
See, his judgments are true and righteous altogether. Read.
More to be desired are they.
See, now these are the things that we want to be desiring. You see, you know, this flesh has got desires of all different kinds. You know, I can't say that I wouldn't want to win the lottery. You know, it make things a little simpler out there. But then again, it'd probably be a big distraction from Yahweh. You see, and so we can start to recognize that, hey, these are the riches that we want to be desiring after right here. You see, more to be desired than fine gold. Read.
More to be desired are they than gold, ye than much fine gold.
That's right. See, we're the richest people on the planet, you know.
That's right.
I used to talk to brethren that I grew up with in class and stuff, and we would just think, we would use lucky, and we didn't know, but we're the most blessed people on the face of the planet by just having a little window of understanding onto our Creator, just having a little knowledge of Him. You see, that can eradicate the darkness that we all came in with, because when He said that we all came dead on arrival, why did we come dead on arrival? Why were we dead, you see? Because we are ignorant of our Creator. That's death. To be carnally minded is death. We our mind was concerning the fleshly things of this world. We didn't understand that they were just types and shadows to bring us onto to Yahshua. Read.
Sweeter also than honey in the honeycomb.
See, this thing is sweet when you see it. Read.
Moreover, by them is thy servant warned.
Yep. See, that's in these things, there's a warning too. You see, because we're seeing it. You know, his wrath is as great as his love. See, okay, let's go back over to the scripture in Hebrews 11, start, or Hebrews 9, start 31. And, want to figure out something real quick, just so he was talking about the bones. Before you leave, he already left Psalms. I wrote a verse down there that, because we got in Exodus, I believe you can pick it up in 12 and 46, where it talks about that no bone should be broken of the Passover lamb, but that's in the prophets too. It sounds, what's that? I wrote it down on your notebook here. Psalms
34:20.
34:20.
Psalms 34:20.
Mm-hmm.
He keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken.
Okay, so David's picking up in the Psalms, he keepeth all his bones, not one would be broken. See, so when you go over there and you read that the soldier come to him, and seeing that Yahshua was already died, and he pierced him in the side, because no bones of him were to be broken. See, it goes by the law and to the prophets, just like this lamb back here. You pick that up at, I think it's Exodus 12 and 46, it talks about that no bone of it shall be broken, you see. So that lamb is going to be pointing out at this lamb, and David in the Psalms is going to pick up that self-same principle, no bone shall be broken, okay? Sure, you can read in Exodus too, it'd be good.
Exodus 12 and 46. In one house shall it be eaten. Thou shalt not carry forth off of the flesh abroad or of the house, neither shall ye break a bone thereof.
See, no bone can be broken, you see. And why is that? What's that? What are these bones pointing to? You see, it's talking about the inner man. You see, his soul is not going to be broken. You see, in fact, he's going to restore it, your soul. That's what we were talking about over there in the other part of the Psalms. It's just, this is just a beautiful teaching. You see, when you see how these things come together. Okay, Hebrews 9.
Hebrews 9 and 1. Mm-hmm. Then verily the first covenant had also orders of service in a worldly sanctuary.
See, we're talking about this old covenant, this old way of worship here. Verily the first covenant had a worldly sanctuary. You see, when he told them to make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. See, that's what he's talking about, is this tabernacle back here. And then more so when they come into the promised land, you see, this stood here for almost 400 years over here. And then it was It was dissolved, and the things that were the things that were inside, you see, were put into the temple. Well, at that point, yeah, because see here, this had skin and hairs on it, you see, likened unto the flesh, you see. But you see over here, the inward parts, like unto your soul, because we're looking at principles here. Your soul is put within the temple. The inner parts of this, you see, were put in the temple here as a physical example, because the temple is pointing out Yahshua's body, you see, and how those things, that inner man, you see, the sons of Yahweh, they're going to be put in the body of Yahshua. Okay.
For in the first compartment of the tabernacle were the candlestick,
yep,
the table, and the showbread.
So it's talking about things that are in this holy place, you see. You have already come right up through the course. See, if you, I know you can't see it on our little illustration here, but the tavern, the court round about was an open court around the holy place and the most holy place, which were a tented over structure, okay? And that's what he's dealing with here. Read.
Which is called the holy place.
Yep, see, we're in the holy place. You got the seven branch lampstand, the table of shewbread, and that the altar of incense. Read.
And beyond the veil, the second compartment of the tabernacle, which
see,
is called the Holy of Holies.
Past that second veil, you see, we got the Holy of Holies, that most holy place, okay? Where we got the Ark of the Covenant. Read.
Which at the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant, overlaid round about with gold.
Yeah.
Wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant.
Yep, so it's telling you everything that's right within that ark, you see. See, you've got the golden pot of manna, you see, and you've got the Ten Commandment law that was placed in there, and Aaron's rod that budded almonds, you see. Read.
And over at the cherubim of the glory, shadowing the mercy seat.
See, now you got his two witnesses here, okay, overshadowing the mercy, that Michael and Gabriel, you've got two witnesses here, because Yahweh is always coming with his witnesses, okay? Read.
Of which we cannot now speak particularly.
Read.
Now, when these things were thus ordained, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service.
Yep, see, that he had a daily service here. So you're going to find out that there was a morning sacrifice and there was an evening sacrifice. Read.
But in the second, with the high priest alone, once every year.
See, here you've got the Day of Atonement was the only time the high priest could go into the most holy place, you see. And there was three trips into this most holy place. You had that he went in there for the sins of the people. You see, this went in there for his sins and his family's sins. And then you had the third trip was for the cleansing of the sanctuary, okay?
Sure.
Now, that's important because you're going to see how Yahshua fulfilled those things, okay?
Not without blood, which he
offered
now, for himself.
He went in there not without blood. Let's jump over real quick to Leviticus 17:11. It's important to establish these things and just see how that they come right out of the law and the prophets, you see?
That's right.
Leviticus 17:11.
Yep, read.
For the life of the flesh is in the blood.
See, now he's picking up Moses and the law of Moses here. He's picking up now the life of the flesh is in the blood. Read.
And I have given it to you upon the altar.
See, now he has given it to you on the altar. He's talking about back here in the tabernacle. You see, this thing it's been given to you in the altar. You see, that blood of the sacrifice was put on the four horns of that altar. Well, what's that point to? See, what's that circuit of the sun with the cross point to? What's all these examples are pointing to? You see, that one Yahshua is going to come and he is going to be the lamb that taketh away the sin of the world. You see, his blood was going to make atonement once and for all. All these others are types and shadows. You see, can you imagine having the type as the sun? Do you realize how great the sun is? And I worked with this just a little bit, just on the numbers. But it's incredible. You know that the earth only receives one millionth of the power or the radiance that the sun even puts out. That's all that ever makes it to the earth. And the earth only absorbs less than 1% of that. That's incredible. I mean, you're talking about less than 1% of one millionth of what this has. That's some serious power. And that's just the example, you see. And that thing is running a circuit to show you the actual. You see, read.
To make an atonement for your souls.
That's right. He's making atonement for your souls. Read.
For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul.
See, so back under the law here, It's the blood was to make an atonement for your souls, you see? So that innocent sacrifice was going to die so that a sinner could live. That's the principle that you're getting here with these blood sacrifices, okay? Why? Because Yahshua is going to come in. He's going to be that only true sacrifice, you see, that's going to take away the sin of the world, you see? And he gave up his blood, you see? This death that he died was what they say that the crucifixion was one of the worst deaths anyone could ever die, you see? And he was a bloody mess. It talks about that his visage was marred beyond recognition. In other words, he was beat up so bad you couldn't even recognize him physically, so, you see? And, you know, they've made movies that The Passion was pretty good portrayal of that. You see that even that, you couldn't even touch. You couldn't mess someone up enough, even in Hollywood, to show how bad they beat him up, okay? Read.
Therefore I said unto the children of Israel, no soul of you shall eat blood, neither shall any stranger that sojourneth among you eat blood.
Okay, that's good. Back over to Hebrews, please.
Thinking right, Hebrews 9 and 6.
Okay.
Now, when these things were thus ordained,
yep.
The priest went always into the first tabernacle, according accomplishing the service.
That's right. So he went into this holy place. He had a service there. He had to light that there could be no darkness in here. You see, it had to be light at all times. You see, and he had his meals here at the table of showbread. You got 12 loaves of bread, you see, and then there was a prayer offered up at this altar, you see, showing there's an intercession between, see, that priest was as an intercession between the people and Yahweh. Read.
But in the second, with the high priest alone, once every year,
mm-hmm.
Not without blood.
See, this was, he could not go in there without blood. Why? Because it was going to be of necessity that this blood of Yahshua was going to make an atonement for your soul. Read.
Which he offered for himself,
mm-hmm.
And for the heirs of the people.
That's right. See, he went in. There was three trips, one for the heirs of the people, one for himself and his family, and then there was a cleansing of the sanctuary. You see? Now look at what he done. If he come in, and he's a sacrifice of sacrifice, you see, and he atoned for all these sins of the world, you see, and he had taken those things away, and he had nailed it to his cross. See, and he did that one time. How ridiculous to go back here and to dive back into these things that weren't even given to us. You see, as Gentiles, we were never given this law. Read.
The Holy Spirit signifying this, that the way into the Holy of Holies was not yet made manifest.
See, back here, this was just a signifying, you see, but the way had not been made it into the Holies of Holies yet. But guess what? Yahshua, he come in, he told you that the way, he was the way. You see, now he's going to make a way. And he told them, you see, that, I'll go ahead and read.
While the first tabernacle was yet standing.
You see, it hadn't been, the way hadn't been made while this first tabernacle was yet standing, or the temple was standing. Read.
Which was a figure for the time.
See, these are figures for the time then present. Read.
And which were offered both gifts and sacrifices.
That's right.
That could not make him that did the service perfect.
See, these things, it doesn't matter how holy you thought you were, you see. It doesn't matter how holy the people thought you were, how good you look, or how well you dressed. See, this was a glorious building. But guess what? It was just a type and a shadow, you see, to bring you unto Yahshua. Read.
As pertaining to the conscience.
And it could not, these things could not make them, year after year, you see, there was an atonement. That day of atonement, then sin was forgiven. The next year, the day of atonement, sin was forgiven. Year after year, could not make them perfect, could not make them right. And this, the eyes of Yahweh, you see, as pertaining to their conscience, you see. Read.
Which stood only in meal and drink offerings.
See, this only stood in meat and drink offerings. Read.
And various washings.
See, in various washings, all these different carnal ordinances. Read.
And carnal ordinances imposed on them. Until the time of reformation.
See, these things were imposed upon them. Read.
But the Messiah being a high priest of
see,
the
now
days,
look, you got this example to look at with this high priest. But now he's saying, but now the Messiah is made high priest. Read.
But the Messiah being a high priest of good things to come.
See, he is the high priest of good things to come. What's he talking about? You see, that he, after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, he is that way, the truth, and the life. Always has been. But see, he made a way for mankind to come back unto the Father. You see, he is the intercessor that this was pointing out back here. You see, there was an intercession with the priesthood that would communicate between Yahweh and man. But guess what? You don't need a priesthood. You don't need to go confess to no Holy Father. That's nonsense. You see, you got the priesthood. He's operating right within you now, you see. Read.
By a greater and more perfect tabernacle.
See, now this is a greater and more perfect tabernacle here with the migration, but so is your body, you see, because this is a, you look up a tabernacle and it's a temporary abode, a transient shelter, you see, especially the human body, you see, and it's a place for your soul to rest. Read.
Not made with hands.
You see, this is not made with hands. Read.
That it say, not of this building.
See, he's not talking about this building. You see, the physical, it doesn't matter you got a crystal cathedral or St. Peter's Basilica or Notre Dame or any of those places. And you see, well, go ahead, read.
Neither by blood of goats and calves.
See, it's not a physical way of worship anymore. See, neither by the blood of goats and calves or the ashes of a heifer, read.
But by his own blood.
You see, by his own blood. It was Yahshua's blood that made the atonement, you see. Read. And that's what can, see, that's where you want to be, that's what you want to be conscious of, is that how Yahshua did these things according to the law and to the testimony, you see. He went through his death, burial, resurrection. Not just that, his ministry, his life, his conception, birth, and flight, you see, his baptism and ministry, everything that he's doing, the creation, it's all. He's showing you that he did it according to a tabernacle pattern. You see that pattern of himself. It's giving you great witness. It's giving you great faith that these things are true. You see, and those are the things that can purge your conscience of dead works. You can forget about trying to work up on your own righteousness. You can forget about going to someone that you think looks good. You can forget about all the ways that you thought were right. You see, because all the ways of mankind weren't right. They were wrong. The only right one was Yahshua. It always has been that way. Read.
He entered in once in the holy place.
See, he entered in once. Entered in once. You see? Read.
Having obtained eternal redemption for us.
Eternal redemption for us. He had a reason to go through these things, you see. These periods of dark and light. You see, this death, burial, resurrection going down through the ages and dispensations. Look at what he's got back here. Look what he's got down here after this great judgment is over. And we're not far off, people, you know. There is going to be a judgment. So you want to be in your house and you want to be partaking of that lamb. You see, because that's what, that during these plagues down here, they need to be in their house. They need to be taking part of that lamb, you see. But guess what? He has got offspring, you see. There is an eternal inheritance to be had. Eternal, that means forever. You'll be with Yahshua forever. Read.
For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of a heifer.
You see, because of the blood of
sprinkling the unclean sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh.
Read.
How much more?
See, those things were only pertaining to the flesh that sanctified the purifying of the flesh. Now, how much more? Read.
Shall the blood of Yahshua, who through the eternal spirit offered himself.
Don't deny the blood of Yahshua. These things were done for a purpose. He done nailed those physical ways of worship to the cross. You see, and brought in a new and better way for us. You see, this spirit of the spirit of the law of life, you see, there's nothing new about that. That's the spirit of Yahshua that's been operating throughout all of eternity, but you see, he has made a way for us to come. That by that outpouring of the Holy Spirit unto the Jews first, and then unto the Gentiles some 7 years later. You see that? Now that's the promise fulfilled that was given to Abraham. That in his seed, all of the nations of the world would be blessed. You see, this is the blessing that we want to look at. You see, that Holy Spirit in us. And it doesn't come by magic. It comes by the preaching of the cross. It comes by the preaching of Yahshua.
Yep.
You see, these things are powerful. In Romans 1:16, he says, and I'm not ashamed of the power of the gospel of Messiah, because it's the power of Yahweh unto salvation. This thing has got some power. It can resurrect you from the dead. You see, we think that there's manifestations out there that are powerful. You see, like when you've got someone who's in trouble and that adrenaline kicks in, that represent the Holy Spirit, mind you, it's a type. You see, people, I seen this thing where this guy lifted a helicopter off of someone. Was down, they wrecked this helicopter and the guy was pinned and he lifted up. Now that's just the manifestation of some power to save someone. But this is the true power here of how that a soul can be saved from damnation. Read.
Without blemish to the Most High Yahweh, purge your conscience from.
See, without blemish, he can present you blameless. Blameless, without blemish, to the Most High. Now, how about that? Here's my son in whom I'm well pleased. That's something. We were riffraff people. And he can present you faultless. Read.
From death-causing works to serve the living Elohim.
See, he purged you from those physical ways of works so that you can read that again.
From the beginning?
No, just, yeah, right from that last verse that you had.
Purge your conscience from death-causing works to serve the living Elohim.
That's right. He can purge your conscience from death-causing works to serve the living Elohim. Read.
And for this purpose, he is the mediator of the New Testament.
See, now, for this purpose, this is the mediator you want to look unto, you see? Read, he's the mediator of the New Testament.
That by means of death for the redemption of transgressions of the First Testament, those which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance.
That's right. Read.
For where a covenant is.
Now look at here. They entered into the agreement here, this old covenant. The law was spoken down to Israel. You see, and they said, all that Yahweh said, we will do. They all entered into a marriage, as it were. They said their I do's. Now, back here under the law, you couldn't get out of a marriage, you see, if your husband died, then you can get out of it, okay? So back here, as a marriage unto them, they've entered into this marriage with Yahweh. So until the self-same one that gave them the law comes in and dies, they're bound to this. You see, Israel was. You see, we were bound to this. Law was never given to a Gentile. You see? Read.
For where a covenant
is. You know, and the founder used to, this cracks me up sometimes. He might go as far as, if you can find in there where a Gentile is baptized, I'll eat the book. You know? And you imagine trying to chew through a Bible. But he was confident that these things were not given unto the Gentile. It was given to the Jews and the Jews alone. Read.
For where a covenant is, there must also of necessity be the death of that which ratifies.
All right, so where a testament is, there must of necessity also be the death of the testator. You see, because why?
For a covenant is made firm over the death of the victim. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all, while that which ratifies it alive.
You see this right here? Is that pretty good?
No. Well, I can't see
anything. You can't see
anything
because of the light. Yep. Well, this is, I'll just read it for you. This is my Bible. And it's right in here. It says, the New Testament of our Savior, and I've got, because it's a Holy James got Bible. It's usually it says, our Testament of our Lord Savior Jesus Christ in here. And then you go right to the next thing, because we're reading in here that the New Testament was brought in. And it was brought in by what? The death of the testator. So this is after Yahshua goes through his death, burial, and resurrection. Because you're going to read on, and it's going to say it's because it's of no force while the testator liveth, right? So we got in here the New Testament, and then what do we got? Matthew 1 and 1. Let me see Matthew 1, 21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from their sin. His birth. Guess what, people? Oh, that was the wrong one. There it is. It's no good. It's no good. That's a man-made mistake. That's not the New Testament. It's not written with pen and ink. He already told us. That's a big mistake.
Yeah.
Read.
Whereof neither the first covenant was confirmed without blood.
That's right. This wasn't confirmed without blood. You see, so how much more in his blood?
Yeah.
Read.
For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law.
See, going back here, he had spoken all the precepts according to the law. Read.
He took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool.
You see, and he, this thing was put forth with blood, right? Read.
In hyssop and sprinkled both the book and all the people.
Yeah.
Saying, this is the blood of the covenant which Yahweh hath enjoined unto you.
See, he enjoined them with blood. This was a blood ceremony back there. See, now look at some of these examples back here with blood. Look at that. Look at this being the door here, and then what? They're dipping this. This reminds me of them dipping the blood in that basin. You see, they dip from a basin of blood, and they struck. I'm going to use this as the door. They struck the door, the two side and the upper dive post, and they're dipping from. What are we making here, people?
Cross.
A cross. It's in the configuration of a cross. Why are they doing that? Because this is pointing to this. This is pointing to that Yahshua is going to die on his cross. And guess what? You know, he was talking about that people are going to be dragging around the wood. They're stuck in that physical way of worship. You know what? If you look at the etymology of wood, because last week we were talking about that he cleared by the sweat of his face, he's going to clear that he carried some wood. And Noah and his family, they carried some wood. And Isaac, see, he carried the wood. And they come out of here with their knee troughs. They carry the wood. There was ongoing fire here. He carried his wood. You see, there's a carrying of wood all down through the law of the prophets. But you know what? If you look up wood and you get into the etymology, it's going to take you to truth. You see? It's going to take you to truth. So that's the wood that we want to be carrying around. See, he's already bared our cross, you see, as it were. He bared his cross and he bared our cross. And even your physical body is pointing to that he's going to be hung on a cross because you've got your lumbar, right? That's wood. And you've got your clavicles. It makes a cross, you see? So your flesh is hanging from a cross, showing that he's going to die on a cross, you see? There's so many things. See, you see these right here, the keys? All you lawyers have thrown away the keys. You see, he's talking about the law and the prophets are pointing to Yahshua, you see? And then you've got that witness on you. The clavicle means key, you see? These things are so... This is a beautiful teaching. Read.
Moreover, he sprinkled likewise with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry.
Right.
And almost all things are by the law purged with blood.
See, almost, we read back there in Leviticus, you see, almost, and then he's picking it up here, self same thing. Almost all things, see, are purged with blood. Read.
And without shedding of blood is no remission.
That's key. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission, you see. Without the shedding of Yahshua's blood, there is no remission. You see, these things, see, they are vitally important things, you see. Now, let's jump over here to Revelation 12. You're going to see how that even the mystery of iniquity, when he's overcome, see, he's overcome with Yahshua's blood, you see. And this right here, him being the lamb slain, this is a great coming down for him. This is a ontological state of perfection, you see? So when he comes, this is a death. That's why he's the lamb slain. This is a great coming down for him. But you know what? It's thought, word, and deed, you see? He was committed to the purpose right from the get-go, and you can see that. Now look at here how some of these things, well, let's pick this up first. Revelation 12, there was a war in heaven.
7:12-7.
Revelations 12:7.
Mm-hmm.
And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of Yahweh, that they should feed her there 1,260 days.
Okay, read.
And there was war in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
That's
and
right.
The dragon fought his angels.
See, now there was a great war in heaven. You see, we're talking about over here in the angelic creation, here in the creative age. Read.
And he prevailed not.
See, now that Lucifer, that mystery iniquity, he prevailed not. But he did deceive 1/3 of the angels were cast out of there. Read.
Neither was their place found anymore
see,
in heaven.
Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. Read.
And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which
mm-hmm.
deceiveth the whole world.
Yep.
He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Read.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our...
Now salvation was needed in heaven. Read.
In the kingdom of our... Elwa and the power of his Messiah.
See, the power of his Messiah. You see, they recognize the power of his Messiah. Read.
For the accuser of our brethren is cast down.
You see that accuser of our brethren. Is he up to anything different down here?
No.
He's still accusing the brethren, you see. We're still accusations being brought around. People are claiming that you got to get off blood, water, spirit, 40. You see, that's colossal ignorance. You see, to see how that's the power of Yahweh unto salvation.
Yep.
Read.
Which accused them before our Allah day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb.
See, they were overcome by the blood of the Lamb. And what?
And by the word of their testimony.
And by the word of their testimony. These are the things that the power of life and death are in the tongue. You see, there's some power in the preaching of
That's
this
right.
gospel. There's some
That's
power
right.
in talking about Yahshua and how he's done these things. You see, we got to wake up, people.
That's right.
You know, it ain't got long. This thing's going to get wrapped up, and you need to recognize what Yahshua has done for you. Okay, let's go over to back over to the scripture reading, please. I want to show you something real quick, too, some things that we've been talking about here with this chart, you see? Because this days of creation are going right by this tabernacle pattern, you see? Because you've got a division of light and darkness. On the first day, he divided light from the darkness. Now, what did he do down here but divide the light from the darkness? Because, you see, you're going to read that the Israel, they had light in their dwellings, but it was total darkness unto the Egyptians. And then they had that phenomenal cloud, even when they're coming up out of there. And it was light unto the Hebrews, and it was darkness unto the Egyptians.
That's
He's
right.
making a division between light and darkness. Then what happens? You see, on the second day, you've got a division of waters, you see? So they come through the parted waters of the Red Sea. See, there was a division of waters there, you see?
Yep.
And then that one seed, he called him his one son. That's his seed that was going to go down there. Abraham,
That's
that was
right.
Abraham's seed. That seed comes up, you see, and they're going to be fruitful and multiply. So what do you got on the third day? You see that seed of vegetation comes forth, and it comes into the perfection of fruition. You see, he's going to be fruitful and multiply. You see, it's a beautiful love story. And guess what? This goes the same stories right here. You run by this. You see, here you've got the division of light and darkness because you've got in the day you shall eat, you shall surely die, right? That's light. He's telling the truth. And the day you eat, you shall surely die. Well, what's it? Mr. Iniqui said? You shall not surely die. Light and darkness. You see,
it's
being deciphered there. You see, so that's the first day there. You've got the division of waters. It talks about how that there's waters above and the waters beneath. You've got the division of waters here. Now, what do you got here? It says Abraham's given that promise and that his seed would go down in a strange land that he know not. You see, it's talking about that seed. And guess what? That seed does come up out of there. You
that's
see?
Right.
That's, that's the first day, the second day, and the third day. You see, represented there. But, you know, go ahead.
Hebrews 9:23.
Mm-hmm.
It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these.
You see, that it is necessary that the things in heaven, you see, that they be purified with these. Read.
But the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these.
Even the heavenly things, even better sacrifices than these. Read.
For the Messiah is not entered into the holy places made with hands.
See, this physical way of worship is over, people.
Right. Yeah.
He done nailed those things to his cross. Read.
Which are the figures of the true.
These are figures. These were, where is that? These things were unto us in samples for our admonition. You know where that is?
I'll get it.
That go ahead and keep reading, Rob. We'll get that. This time I got.
But into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of Yahweh for us.
Oh, man, no time. Oops. Okay, we'll wrap her up here. Keep reading.
Nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest entered into the holy place every year with other blood.
See, these things were continuous examples over and over and over again. And you pick up, and I think it's Paul's ready to see that these things were in samples for us, for our admonition. This was for our learning, for us to build up, to bring us unto the Messiah, to show that he did these things for once, to purge you of these this old way of worship, that your conscience could be purged of dead works. You see, it's a beautiful teaching. We've run out of time. I hope someone got something out of today's class. And all honor and praise and glory go to Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah. We're going to have the doxology. So I'm going to continue to read off of here until I get it right. Doxology is taken from the last two chapters of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence presence of his glory with exceeding joy to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.